Hello, students of Africa. I hope you are well. We've been giving a great deal of consideration to the problem of colonization and now colonialism. And today I want to discuss with you how that dark period in the history of the continent came to an end. So, in your notes, you should have a heading that says the independence movements in Africa. The Pan-Africanism movement that began in the early part of the 20th century gave some hint of what was to come, because during that time, there started to be a change in consciousness amongst a lot of Native African peoples, where they were reassessing the value of their own culture and traditions as against the European traditions that had come and were being laid down on top of them. And that was perhaps the beginning of a kind of renaissance, but it did not ultimately lead to the independence movements. It had some consequences in American history, which you'll probably study next year in US history. For example, the great African-American scholar and professor W.E.B. Du Bois was a part of this Pan-African movement, and he taught at Harvard, but ultimately decided that he wanted to go back to Africa, where his roots were, and actually trace them back to the Gold Coast, where we've been spending time with Homegoing, and spent the last years of his life in Ghana. And there's a W.E.B. Du Bois Center there, which you can visit if you ever go. But it was only after World War II, which you may know spans roughly 1939 to 1945, that a kind of nationalism developed in the various colonies that would ultimately be the mechanism through which these colonies would gain their independence. So nationalism is the key term there. And you may know that nationalism really took hold in Europe throughout the 19th century. And the contrast between that situation and the one that was found in the colonies is instructive. So there were three hurdles to independence, especially through this form of kind of national unification that the colonies faced. And the first was that, as we have seen, the borders of these colonies were drawn with very little regard for ethnic and tribal differences. So within one colony, you would have a number of tribes who, before the Europeans came, might not have had any real relation with one another. In fact, they may have had hostile relations. So in Nigeria, for example, you have the Igbo or Igbo that I've mentioned before, and the Yoruba and the Hausau. And these people, of course, spoke different languages and had really different cultures. So coming together to overthrow the colonial oppressor was going to be a challenge, because they were going to have to put aside those differences and work together in order to do that. And that proved difficult in some cases. Second, the economic interest of various groups within the colonies diverged. So sociologists have identified about 7 different socioeconomic groups that existed typically within a given colony. And I'm not going to go through all of them, but what's important to note is that these groups perhaps felt differently from one another towards the whole system of colonial rule. So at the top of those different levels would have been African professional people like lawyers and doctors who generally served the families of Europeans. So their economic interests were actually allied with those of wealthy merchants, contractors, government officials who lived in Africa. So if the colonial government were overthrown and these families had no real purpose anymore in Africa, the livelihood of these African professionals would be seriously in jeopardy. And then all the way down to like peasant farmers who actually were generally so far removed from the center of governance that they didn't necessarily care who was in charge at the top. What they cared about was the agricultural policies that would affect them. So if it was a European power or if it was a native African power, didn't matter to them so much as that the policies around agriculture would be supportive of them. So they weren't necessarily interested in seeing an end to colonial rule. Some were, of course. So that's the second point, these divergent economic interests. And those would be hard to overcome for a similar reason as the first point. Then thirdly, as you can imagine, the colonial authorities suppressed these independence movements as they started to emerge. And agitators, as they were called, were jailed. In some cases, the leaders of these early nationalist groups were even banished from the colony so that they could not have influence there at home. What's interesting as we go forward in history is that some of those people who were jailed or even exiled ultimately became the first leaders of the free African nations. So that was the case with Nelson Mandela, who you may know from South Africa. Also, in our case, we've been studying a lot the Gold Coast. First leader of Ghana is going to be Kwame Nkrumah, who was exiled for a time, Kenyatta in Kenya as well. So that's kind of looking ahead to the future. The nationalism that, as I said, would become the key to creating the independence movements found its home in 3 different kinds of organization. One was actually religious organizations. So these were in many cases breakaway groups from the Christian mission churches. And as in the case of the other two groups that I'm going to talk about, they did not form originally with the goal of seeking independence for the colony. Rather, they were just like-minded people who, in this case, started to revalue traditional African religions and gathered together, in some cases weekly, in order to practice those religious faith traditions. So that was a place where there started to be an interest in nationalism and independence. Second were trade unions and welfare associations. So these folks originally formed in order to get better working conditions for laborers, whether that meant higher wages or better benefits or safer conditions. That was why they formed. And in the case of the welfare associations, it was to help their own people who were coming in from the countryside, from the farms, to get jobs in the emerging cities. And oftentimes there was a readjustment period, and folks chipped in to help and give advice to folks as they made that transition to urban living. So again, they did not originally form with the goal of independence in mind, but rather with trying to help one another under the colonial economic policies. And then lastly were some political parties. Some of these actually began as youth clubs and movements. And originally they were formed in order to push for some modest reforms to the colonial rule. But as they became more emboldened, these political parties started to be centers of activity for independence. So I just want to make sure that you understand that it is easier for nationalism to develop in a country that is more homogeneous than a lot of these African colonies that contained, in some cases, dozens of different tribes, each with their own regional dialects. So in a place like Japan, for example, or France, it's much easier to develop a kind of national spirit and feeling of unity than in these places, which again had been put together by the European colonizers. As it turns out, the first country in Africa to win its independence was the Gold Coast, which, as we know, Kwame Nkrumah decided to name Ghana instead. And while I was in Ghana, I picked up this postcard, which I sent to you by email as well. I don't know if you can see it here, but the quote is, "The independence of Ghana is meaningless unless it is linked with the total liberation of Africa." It's a famous quote of Nkrumah. And he actually put his money where his mouth was on that. He used a lot of the surplus that had been built up by the Gold Coast authorities to fund national independence movements at other colonies in order to support them, because he really felt that if Ghana was just surrounded by European powers, it was not going to have a secure future. So he really wanted to see other colonies get their independence as well. So the upshot of the years of struggle, which spanned from 1956 with Ghana's independence and probably going all the way to 1994, really, with South Africa and the end of the apartheid regime, is that, one, the vast majority of African states achieved their independence without violence, without much bloodshed at all, through what turned out to be a pattern of agitation in the streets, with these three different kinds of organizations coming together and pushing for independence. And then the colonial powers, once Ghana went, realizing, you know, seeing the writing of the wall, that this was probably what the future looked like, the colonial powers negotiating with these nationalist leaders for the terms of independence. So there were all these companies, and then in some cases, families that had spent a lot of time, decades in Africa, and what were the terms in which they were going to be allowed to exit, that certain economic interests were going to be allowed to be held on to as they exited, etc. All these had to be negotiated. But that's the way it happened in most places. Second, what you ended up with after the Europeans left in each colony was a patchwork of organizations from different ethnic and language groups that had come together for the purpose of achieving independence, defeating the common enemy, but actually had very little experience working together and were now in charge of governing a huge country. So that was going to present its own set of challenges in the post-colonial period. Third, it was in the so-called settler colonies where lots of whites had come to live in places like Kenya, southern Rhodesia, South Africa, and whose families had been there for decades, generations had been raised there. It was in those places that a violent struggle would be necessary in order to achieve independence. And so there are a number of kind of famous bloody wars that were waged in places like Kenya, where you had the Mau Mau Rebellion that started in the 50s and didn't get its independence until 1963, so 7 years after Ghana got its. Southern Rhodesia had to fight for a long time, and it wasn't until 1980 that they became the independent country of Zimbabwe. And excuse me, as I've already mentioned, South Africa, 1995. There were other places that aren't technically considered to be settler colonies, like Algeria, that France like really had come to depend on. It was just across the Mediterranean, and France did not let go easily of Algeria. And so there was like what's called the Algerian Revolution or the Algerian War that lasted for quite a few years before Algeria got its independence. So that's the kind of threefold upshot of these independence movements. And I look forward to talking with you about this material and hearing your thoughts and questions when we meet next online. Okay. Thanks for your good attention. Take care. Bye-bye.